Now what I'm going to do is I'll run the bow tie test here, which is scientifically completely meaningless, but this is a pretty useful waveform for amplifier testing, for testing linear responses, things like that. And this executes here. Let me start that a second time, and I don't even need to let that finish. I'll just stop that. And then we're going to go to the data navigator, and here the paradigm that we just recorded includes four routine data sets, four series, two of the MyIV and two of the bowtie test. And with the paradigm highlighted, I can review the paradigm data, which gives me the two IV routines and the one complete and one manually stopped bowtie test routines. This window, by the way, this window behaves very similar to the reanalysis window that we saw earlier. We also got the overview navigator up here that we can use to go back and forth, etc., etc. And if I highlight this one, right click on it and go analyze, it'll open this routine data set, this series, in a reanalysis scope. And now I can edit the measurements, look at the either last executed or the measurements that were stored with the original routine. And as I run the analysis, it recreates the real-time analysis, the IV that we plotted in real-time. But obviously, we can change the measurements if we want to look at something else. What we can also look at is the metadata. Let's go to the data navigator to do that. We have a bunch of metadata associated with this paradigm here. We started the paradigm, and here we have things like we recorded this on a Mac, which has a name, and with Sutterpatch version 203, build 214, a lot of these parameters. And then at one point we started a routine, the first routine that we started, move over here, has a description of the individual signals that were recorded, the serial number of the amplifier we used, the revision of the amplifier, the firmware version, things like that. We have the series resistance, the membrane capacitance, all the values that were stored when I last close the membrane test, and that all gets automatically determined. What I can do is I can add metadata to data that I would record from here. So for example, for the animal species, in this case, we want to record from mouse, and the animal age could be, say, 6, and I purposely put a numerical value here so I can make an age row or something like that, because my age units would be 6 days. A young mouse that we recorded from the tissue, for example, we would use brain, and that would be a brain slice. We can create an identifier that automatically increments by experiment. For example, I could start counting at 17 and then increment that by 1 for each experiment, and can also get a prompt or confirmation before the experiment if I want to make sure I'm really recording from 17 today and didn't like skip one that I don't have there. And there's a number of parameters for the cells. If the parameters here aren't enough for you, what you can do is in the preferences, you can control the detail level, and let's just quickly look at the full details. I need to close this for the changes to go in effect. So here we have more fields, the operator, the experiment, the electrode. I mentioned that earlier, for example, the pipette puller. If you have three pullers and one of us always gives me smaller currents than the other one, which would be kind of odd, you could track the serial number. You can add information about the stimulus, compound concentration, the compound lot, things like that. Nobody would populate all 600 and some meta parameters that we have right now, and then around midnight start their experiments finally. But the idea is to give you a structured place to store the data that you think is relevant for your particular type of experiment. And then, yeah, this here, the metadata review is one way where you can see that. What else do we store? With the routine, we're looking at the routine. A copy of the routine that we executed is also stored, and nobody wants to read the text description of what's going on, but in most cases, the waveform preview gives you all the information that you need, shows you, okay, yeah, this is what I did. And what you can do is you can either copy that to your routine pool or activate it and run it as is. The benefit of that is you can proliferate a routine across multiple rigs that you may have in your lab, or you can reproduce what your collaborator halfway around the world did, or if you get unexpected results and you want to make sure that you created the routine so that it makes sense, I would ask you to send me an experiment file and then copy your routine to my routine pool, and that way I can run the exact same routine that you did and can see, okay, does this behave as expected? Did you make a mistake setting it up, which of course would never happen, or at least I would never tell you? Or is it a bug in the software, which of course also doesn't happen, so this whole thing won't happen. Anyway, we also have the analysis associated with, in our case, the MyIV, the IV curves. You can look at that, and you can look at the graphs or the table. You can scale and add that, append, average, etc., etc. One more thing I would like to briefly talk about is how do we create an output, like a printable output of my data. We analyze an individual routine, zoom in on the x-axis a little bit because the currents aren't particularly big, and then run the analysis, run our IV analysis again, and then click on this little scroll here, which creates a layout with my active windows. Let's make that a little bigger here. And what I can do then is do a right click here, show this window, and this is a regular Igor graph that I can modify, for example, by double clicking on the data. I can select them all by holding the shift key and making them all black, because it's not likely that I want to pay for a color figure for this here. You can obviously modify axis labels, get rid of the grid lines or something like that. Modify your figure as you would be used to in Igor. Scale by using the scroll wheels here, the horizontal and vertical scroll wheel in this case. And all this then updates to the layout. So you can create your publication figures, if you're used to doing it with Igor, right within SutterPatch. One of the big advantages of having SutterPatch within Igor.
Follow along the next episode in the series, or jump to the playlist for other informative videos. Subscribe now to keep up with the latest installment.